Hallelujah.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
I say, praise the Lord.
Amen.
I did not hear you. Seem like you are not happy. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Okay, if you are in the house, let me hear a born again. Amen.
Amen.
You are getting there. Let me hear a born again. Amen.
Amen.
The Lord is good.
All the time.
I said the Lord is good.
All the time.
And all the time.
The Lord is good.
Thank you, my Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. We praise your name. Amen.
Thank you, my Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Amen. Hallelujah.
I want to sing dance before the presence of your God. Thank you, my Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. I praise your name. Somebody say a big amen. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Let us have our seat. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Last week we were talking about something exciting, and by the grace of God, I will see if the Holy Spirit will let me round up that today. But if I cannot be able to do that, well, we can continue next week. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
I want to announce once more that the vision of this ministry is restoring the church and engaging in the supernatural.
Amen.
Praise
Amen.
The Lord.
Amen.
The world must get their answer back from the church. Not the church going back to the world to seek for answer. The world must rush to the church to seek for answer. The world must come to the church to seek for solution. The world must go back to the church to ask questions. Is somebody listening to me?
Amen.
The answer to the problems of this generation must come back from the church. Is somebody listening to me?
Oh, yes.
So that's why I started saying last week, I said the glory will return back to the church.
Amen.
Somebody say amen.
Amen.
So we were talking about the glory of the later house, the glory of the present house. The Bible says in Haggai chapter 2 verse 9, it says, for the glory of this later house shall be greater than of the former. You know, somebody looked at that. I put that on Facebook last week. Somebody tried to correct the grammar there. There was no grammar error. It was just King James. But let me announce to you that the grammar may be wrong, but the anointing is correct.
Amen.
You did not hear me. The grammar may be wrong, but the anointing is correct.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Paul said that I have not come to talk to you with enticing words of man's wisdom. I have come to demonstrate the power of God. So for the glory of this latter house shall be greater than of the former, saith the Lord of hosts. I did not say it. God himself has said it. And if he said it, and I believe it, that settles it. Is somebody listening to me? If God said it, and I believe it, that settles it. It don't matter what people say. When once God says it, your own is to believe it, and that settles it. Whatever God says, you believe it, that settles it.
Amen.
Somebody say amen.
Amen.
Say the glory.
The glory.
Oh no, you are not here yet. Are you still here?
Yeah.
I said the glory.
The glory.
Of the latter house.
Of the latter
shall be greater.
Shall be greater
than of the former.
Than of the former.
I want you people to excuse me. Can you both come this way so you can see exactly what we are doing, because I'm going to be projecting that stuff on the wall. Sister, can you see? Come this way so you can see everything. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
So the glory of this latter house shall be greater than that of the former, saith the Lord of hosts. The Lord of hosts is the one that said it. And in this place, somebody lift up your right hand to heaven. Say, in this place.
In this place.
Now see how I'm doing it. Say, in this place.
In this place.
Now I want you to claim it. Be serious with what you're saying. Say, in this place.
In this place.
In this place.
In this place.
Will I give peace?
Will I give peace?
Say the Lord of hosts.
Say the Lord of hosts.
Who said it?
The Lord of hosts.
Who said it? So what do you have to do? Believe it.
Yes.
That settles it.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
I said praise the Lord.
Amen.
So that's what we were saying last week, and we'll continue right from there. And we were trying to give definitions last week. I'll be really quick. We talked about kabod and we talked about doxa. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
But I don't close my projector. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
So we talked about all those Hebrew terms. You know, the Bible is written in Hebrew. We talked about kabod. We talked about doxa. And we also talked about Shekinah. You still remember? We talked about all those. What is kabod? Kabod simply means glory. That's a Hebrew word. The Bible is written in Hebrew. Now, doxa is a Latin word that still means the same thing, glory. So, kabod in Hebrew is glory. Doxa in Latin is glory. Hallelujah.
Amen.
We are in a school of ministry.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
So, God's glory gives us a proper opinion of who He is. We don't really know how or who God is, but His glory tries to give us some understanding. His glory gives us a proper opinion of who He is, providing a glimpse into His beauty, brilliance, effulgence, splendor, and radiance. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
The Bible says that there was a day that these three inner core members of the apostles, Peter, James, and John, that they made a journey to the mountain with Jesus for a prayer, and it was at night. Now, whilst they were praying, something happened. You still remember the story?
Yeah.
On the mountain of Transfiguration. That while Jesus and the apostles were praying, these three apostles, Peter, James, and John, something happened. The Bible says that suddenly, now, it's amazing that when the Holy Spirit wants to move, it happens suddenly. It takes you unaware because you don't know His time. So suddenly, the face of Jesus transformed. It was like a sun. It was shining. And even His garment was glittering. It was as bright as anything you can think of. And because it was at night, the light that was coming out of the face of Jesus beautified the place. Is somebody listening to me? So the light beautified the place, and Peter got up from sleep. You know, it is easy to wake up from sleep, and you, if you are not careful, if you just start to speak when you get up from sleep, you can begin to speak some things which are nonsense or whatever it is. But the Bible says that as soon as Peter got up from sleep, because it was at night, he saw the beauty of the glory of Jesus. Guess what Peter said? Peter said, oh, how I wish we stayed in this place. How I wish we remain in this place. Because, Lord, if you will give me permission, I will build three temples for you. One for you, one for Elijah, and one for who? Who remember the story? One for Moses. One for Moses, one for Elijah, and one for you. And we will stay here the rest of the day. But I asked Peter, how about the other people down there? So you see, it is easy to get up from sleep and talk nonsense. But Peter was carried by the glory of God. The glory of God is so beautiful. It is such an experience that when you have it, you will never forget it.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
I said, praise the Lord.
Amen.
So Peter had an understanding that day. We don't fully know God. But gradually, as we spend time in His presence, He begins to manifest Himself in various ways. And last week I said that I hate the way preachers use Matthew chapter 18 verse 20. I hate the way preachers use it. This is what most preachers say when they come to a meeting like this and they see that people are few. Hear what they will quote. They will be like, "Where two or three are gathered, God is present in their midst." Well, that's not the purpose why that scripture was written. That scripture was not written to be quoted when people are few. That scripture was written to remind us that whenever people gather in the name of the Lord, it's not just when people are two or three. Whenever people are gathered in the name of the Lord, God Himself is present. Is God present this morning in this place? I did not hear you. Is God present this morning in this place? Let me hear a better amen. Let me tell you, when we were worshiping God this morning, when we were singing praise, I felt the atmosphere different. I don't know if you felt it. The atmosphere was different, and it reminded me that God is present in this place.
Amen.
Somebody shout hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
And I was so happy in my heart. I said, God, thank you, because this is what I asked since Monday till last night. I said, Lord, let your presence be noticed by your worshippers. And I notice His presence. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Let's continue to go. Really quick, I have much to say. And we talked about Shekinah. Shekinah simply means the one who dwells. God loves dwelling among men. That's God. I mean, it is not our initiative for God to come dwell with us. It is His initiative. Shekinah, the one who dwells. And Shekinah glory is the visible manifestation of the presence of God. Can the presence of God be visible? Yes. Now, the presence of God is both invisible and visible. So when I'm talking about engaging the supernatural is the invisible. And the invisible makes sense more than the visible. What happens in the spiritual world makes sense more than what happens right now. Our physical eyes cannot behold things that happen in the spirit world. So the Shekinah glory is the visible manifestation of the presence of God. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
So God is a spirit, He is invisible. But can He be made visible at any time, anywhere? Yes. And when that happens, that is Shekinah glory. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
Let me tell you a story. There was a man called Moses. He was the caretaker of sheep. He was a pastor. Moses was a pastor. Anytime you see the Bible talking about a shepherd and a sheep, it's talking about the pastor and the congregation. So Moses had his congregation. They were the sheep, and he was the shepherd. And on a certain day, Moses saw something strange that changed his life. What did Moses see? Moses saw that there was fire in the bush, yet the bush was still green. There was fire in the bush, but the bush was still green. And so that attracted his attention. The Bible says that when Moses went closer to see what was happening, why should there be fire, yet there is no heat, and the grass is not consumed, the bush is still green? There is something strange about this. When he went closer, a voice spoke from the fire. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
He said, Moses, don't come any closer. Let me tell you one thing about the glory. The glory will not linger around a place of filthiness. The glory will not come close to anywhere that things are not right. Because why? God is holy. Are you listening to me? So Moses was not right at that time to come any closer. So God said, Moses, you holy there. Don't come any closer, because where you are now is a holy ground. Wow. He said, I have chosen you and I'm sending you back to Egypt to liberate my people. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
Moses saw the glory and other things that happened. Moses said, who are you and how will the people believe me? He said, well, tell them that I am the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And I'm going to give you this evidence. evidence so the people will believe. Every time that the glory shows up, there must be an evidence. Is somebody listening to me? Every time that the glory of God shows up, there must be an evidence. And God spoke to Moses. He said, what do you have in your hand? Moses said, I have my shepherd's staff. He said, okay, you throw it on the ground. When he threw it on the ground, it became a serpent. And Moses flee away. God said, don't be afraid. Pick it by the tail. When he picked it by the tail, it became a staff. Somebody say supernatural.
Supernatural.
It was manifestation of the supernatural for the first time before the presence of Moses. And God told him, he said, sign number two, evidence number two, that it is the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob that appeared to you. Put your hands into your clothes. When he put his hand into his clothes and brought it out, it became disease with leprosy. Moses cried, said, no, this is not my hand. God said, good. Now put it back. When he put it back, the hand became normal. Somebody said, amen.
Amen.
When the glory shows up, it shows up for two reasons. The glory comes to protect, and the glory also comes to judge. Is somebody listening to me? I said the glory comes to protect. It comes to make a difference between one people and the other people. It also comes to judge. And in not long from now, I'm going to show you exactly what I'm saying. But let's go down a little bit. We talked about Shakan, which means to dwell. Those are all root words that gives us Shekinah. We also talked about Mishkan, which is tabernacle. So the mind of God is to dwell in the tabernacle. Praise the Lord. And God gave Moses the specific dimension of the tabernacle. He gave Moses the specific dimension of the tabernacle. But I want to, let me quickly go to something right there. Praise the Lord. Now turn your Bible to that. Exodus 25 verse 8. Exodus 25 verse 8. So God's mind is to release his glory on his tabernacle. He said, and let them make me a sanctuary. Somebody say sanctuary.
Sanctuary.
That was the instruction that God gave Moses. Let them make me a sanctuary that I may dwell among them. So it is the mind of God to dwell among men. It is the plan of God. Let me go up one more slide. Up. In Exodus, what we just read now, we see that it was God who first expressed his desire to dwell among men. That was God's initiative, not your initiative. He said to Moses, he said, construct me a sanctuary that I may dwell, Shakan, among them, according to all that I am going to show you as the pattern of the tabernacle, Mishkan, from Shakan. And the pattern of its furniture, just so you shall construct it. In other words, God gave Moses the specific dimension of how the ark should look like. He said, do that for me. Build me an ark. Build me a sanctuary that my glory will descend. Because it is my desire to always be among you. It is God's desire that when we come together in a worship time like this, in a fellowship meeting like this, that God himself should be in the presence. And that's what makes us different from any religious gathering. When we gather here, just like a normal thing, and I always say this, in the absence of revelation, religion becomes tradition. You did not hear me. In the absence of revelation, religion becomes tradition. In other words, what makes us different is that when we come, God has to reveal something. Did you hear me? I said, when we come before his presence, to prove that God is present, he has to reveal himself somehow. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
And he already started revealing himself this morning. The atmosphere was different. I knew God was here. I did not have to think twice. The atmosphere, even as I'm talking now, I still feel something moving from my head down to my toe. That's the evidence. That's something that God is present in this place. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Are you still with me, people?
Sure.
If you sleep, I'm going to turn that AC off. So this place gets hot, that way you will not sleep. Don't sleep on me, okay?
Okay.
But I want to discuss something today. Amen.
Amen.
I want to talk about Ichabod. Remember we said Kabod means glory. But I want to talk about Ichabod, which means no glory. Because in Haggai 2 verse 9, he said the glory of the present house shall be better than that former.
Amen.
So when the glory departs, what should the people do? And I want to give you a nice story that comes from 1 Samuel 4:22. You can spend time at home to read this story. The Bible says that after God has given Moses the instruction to construct the ark, when God had given him all the instruction to construct the ark, God descended in the midst of the Israelites. Now, cut the story short. There is the ark of the covenant. I'm going to show you that picture not long from now. The covenant that God made between Israel and itself, he handed to Moses, and he told Moses to put it in the box, the ark of covenant. That box represents the presence of God, because the Israelites were often carried in worshiping idols and other things. So God wanted to focus their attention on him. And to do that, he told Moses to construct an ark and put the covenant in the ark. So when the people see the ark of God, they will be reminded that God is in their midst. Is somebody following me? So the ark of the covenant represents the presence of God. And God made sure that not everybody will take care of the ark. You must be a priest consecrated to do that. And at this time, there was a priest called Eli. He was the one in charge of the temple. The Bible tells us that when Eli grew old, his sons were helping him with the assignments in the sanctuary. But these boys were evil. Hear what these boys did. These boys will wait for somebody that brings the sacrifice. They will tamper with the sacrifice. They will tamper with the offering. They will tamper with the things of God, holy things, and tamper with it. They will even sleep with the young girls who were serving in the sanctuary. Are you still with me or not? So all these things were happening. God was not happy because his glory cannot be around where sin prevails. And so God made up his mind to leave. And God spoke to the young Samuel, who was a servant to Eli. God revealed himself to Samuel, and Samuel took the message to his master. And to cut this story short, they said on a certain day that Israel was engaged in a fight with the Philistines. The fight was a terrible one. It was an unusual fight. The fight got intense to the point that these two boys who were helping their father, they were killed instantly on that battle. These two boys died the same day on that battle. And that did not end it. The Philistines were able to capture and carry the ark of God away. Can you imagine that you have a God and they capture your God and they take your God away? No, that was not God Almighty taking away. That was something that, like an object, an emblem that stood there to remind them of God's presence. But anyway, the Philistines took the ark away. They carried the ark away. And the message came to the priest Eli. A young man can say, "Master, it is terrible. We have been defeated. Never in history has Israel suffered this kind of defeat." And Eli said, "What happened?" "Well, Master, two of your sons were killed in the battle." And Eli said, "Yeah, so what else?" Now, when he heard that two of his sons were killed, nothing really happened to him, because God had spoken to him that this kind of thing would happen. But God did not tell him that he was going to withdraw his glory. So what happened? The moment that Eli heard that the ark has been taken away, the Bible says that he fell from his chair. He was 98 years old and he was very fat. So he fell from his chair and broke his neck and died instantly. So that was the third person that died that same day. Now the wife of one of the boys that died heard the story. This woman was pregnant, and her pregnancy was at the full age. The moment she heard this, she heard that her husband was killed in the battle, that her son-in-law was killed, and that her father-in-law just died. And she also heard that the ark has been taken away. Bad news. I hate breaking news. Every time you tune the TV, you see breaking news. You know what? Breaking news breaks the heart. But I love good news, because good news will heal the heart. Amen. Somebody shout hallelujah. Hallelujah. I said good news will heal the heart. Amen. The breaking news will break the heart. So there was breaking news that day. The moment this lady heard this, my husband is gone, my husband's brother is gone, my father-in-law is gone, the ark of the covenant is gone. She went into first labor instantly. She went into first labor. The moment that the baby was coming out, that's when she was dying. And the women who were helping her, they said, please don't give up. You just had a baby born. She shook her head and she named the boy Ichabod. No glory. The glory has left Israel. Then she died. It was terrible. But the Bible says that this ark was carried to the Philistine country, to the cities that were under Philistine. The first place that they took the ark to was in Ashdod. And in Ashdod, that was the center for worship for the goddess or the god, the national god of the Philistine. And this national god of the Philistine is called what? Who knows the name? Who knows the name of that god where the covenant, the ark of covenant was taken to? Who remembers the name? Dagon. Dagon. So they took the ark of the covenant of God to Dagon's temple. Imagine somebody bringing your God to that level. Let me tell you that in this life, people provoke us a lot. In this life, they ask you, they say, do you have a God? Can your God speak? What can your God do? If your God is alive, why are you in this situation? If your God is alive, why has things not changed? And they keep provoking you. But I came to announce to you this morning that when the glory comes, all those accusations and whatever it is, they will be silent. Yeah. I said they will be silent. Yeah. There is coming back. There's a day that the glory will come back. And everything that you have struggled, you will rest. You did not hear me. I said you will rest. Amen. When the glory comes, you will rest. Amen. You will not more be in pain, no shame, no sorrow. Oh, my Father. You just need to experience a glimpse of that glory and you will know exactly what I'm talking. So the glory, the ark was taken away. But I said earlier that the glory of God can bring protection and it can as well bring what? Judgment. So the glory of God brought judgment to the Philistines. Look, the glory of God that will come to your life. Are you listening to me? I want you to smile before I speak this. The glory of God that will come to your life, it will threaten your enemies. You did not hear me? I said the glory of God that will come to your life, it will threaten your enemies. It will disgrace your enemies. It will destroy your enemies. If you are believing me, shout upon the dead of mine. The glory of God that will come to your life will bring judgment on your enemies. Let them continue to point hand. Let them continue to talk. Let them continue to curse. Let them just continue. But there comes a day of judgment.
Yes,
there comes a day of judgment when the glory of God will show up. All demons will bow.
Amen. Yes, Lord. Amen. In Jesus' name. Amen.
There comes a day.
Amen.
Keep on believing your God, doing your thing quietly. Amen. But there comes a day of announcement. Ha ha. There comes a day of announcement when the glory will show up. Your enemies will identify the glory and say, this is God. You know, they laugh at us for quite a long time. Good, let them continue to laugh.
Thank you, Jesus.
So they brought the ark of the covenant of God into the temple of Dagon. Dagon is an idol. The worst thing that God hates is comparison. God says that thou shalt have no other God besides me. Hey, yeah, yeah. You remember that story? Uh-huh. Thou shalt have no other God besides who? Besides me. So they brought God. Hey. Beside Dagon. At night, Dagon fell. Let me describe Dagon a little bit. I don't have the picture for Dagon. I wish I remember that. This is how Dagon is. From the waist upward is like a human being. And from the waist downward is the shape of a fish. That's the structure of the god Dagon. Halfway up is human, halfway down is fish. You have a picture now, right? That's how Dagon is. And so they place the ark of the covenant in Dagon's temple, where the people come to worship their God. In the morning, they came and discovered that Dagon was falling face downward. Your enemies will fall. Your struggle. God does it.
Amen.
Hey, hey.
Amen.
Oh, my father, my father. There was a time that Elijah ran away because of the threat. The threat. There came a day that Elijah returned and said, go tell the king that the man of God is here.
Amen.
But he ran away. He ran away for his life. But later on, he came back and said, go tell Ahab, I am here.
Amen.
The glory of God. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
Somebody say amen.
Amen.
Somebody say amen.
Amen.
These people did not realize what was happening. They did not realize what was happening. So they picked up the God and put it back in its place. You know, when God starts to deal with your enemy, they may not realize quick. That's God's pattern. He will not let them realize quick, so that by the time they realize, they are finished. You do not hear me? By the time your enemy will realize, they are gone.
Yeah.
Do you know that when the Israelites were crossing the Red Sea, the Egyptians thought that it was easy. So with their boldness, they followed the Israelites to cross the sea. And they went to the middle. God was just relaxed. By the time they were in the middle, God allowed the water to come back. Now listen, when the water was coming back, some of them are expert in swimming. Expert swimmers, they started to swim. The Holy Spirit came, pulled them back, put them in the middle. All of them perished. That's how God works.
Amen.
God is giving your enemy time to get in well.
Oh, yes.
By the time they are in, God will show up. I say, your God will show up.
Amen.
Your God will show up.
Amen.
Your God will show up.
Amen.
In the name of Jesus Christ. In the morning, the people came again and found that this time Dagon did not just fall, but his neck was cut off and the arms were cut off. That's when they realized that this thing is serious. They said, no, the God of the Israelites is surely dealing with us. We got to do something. So they were making plans to take that ark to somewhere. They did not surrender, but they planned to move that ark to somewhere. When they took that ark to the next place, guess what happened? God struck that village where the ark was. Everybody, child, adults, men and women, everybody had hemorrhage. Pie. I tell you, when the glory of God shows up, there must be evidence.
Amen.
There was pie. People were suffering from pie, crying. And the people realized that, no, the hand of God is heavy upon us. They said, please come take this thing away. We cannot handle this thing. You cannot handle the glory of God. So they took it to the next destination. When the next people heard that they were bringing that ark, they cried, they said, hey, so you want to bring that thing over here so we will perish? Please don't bring it. They said, no, we cannot keep it. Look, it became a problem. Hallelujah.
Amen.
The glory of God will bring judgment to your enemies.
Amen.
I said, let me hear better. Amen.
Amen.
The glory of God will bring judgment to your enemies.
Amen.
In the name of Jesus
Amen.
Christ. So, all this thing happened for 7 months. They could not bear it. They decided to send back the ark. They said, let us try one more thing. We are going to put this ark on the animals to drive it away, to carry it away. Nobody will control the animal. If these animals go back straight to the land of Canaan, then we will believe that truly it was the God of these people that was dealing with us. So they let the animal that carried the ark to go on their own accord. This animal went straight down to the territory of the children of God. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
And that was confirmed that it was God. But this is what happened. The Bible says that the ark was gone for 20 years. The glory left Israel for 20 years. Can you imagine? 20 years it was gone for so long. Do you know that God, when God made Adam, he crowned Adam with glory and honor. And when Adam lost it, we all fell under the Bible quotation of Romans that says that for all have sinned and fall short of the glory, the original glory. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
Now, the Bible says that what the first Adam lost, the second Adam restored it. Somebody say restoration.
Restoration.
It's coming back. Restoration of the glory is coming back. So what Adam lost, Jesus brought it back.
Amen.
Somebody say amen.
Amen.
Wow. The glory of the Lord. Now look at that scripture right there. John 17 verse 5. I'm trying to round up. He said, and now, oh Father. That was the prayer that Jesus made. Now, he said, and now, oh Father, glorify thou me with thy own self, with the glory which I had with thee before the world was. You know, when I was typing this thing, I thought it was wrong grammar. The grammar may be wrong. The anointing is correct. You remember that? So I looked at it over and over to make sure that I did not miss it. He said, and now, oh Father, that was Jesus praying, glorify thou me with thy own self, with the glory which I had with thee before the world was. In Genesis, God says, let us make man in our image and after our likeness. Man was crowned with glory and with honor. But when the first Adam fell, he lost the glory and the honor. Now, the second Adam left the throne. He was stripped off of the glory. He became ordinary man like me and you. And so that's why Jesus was saying that, oh, Father, glorify thou me with thy own self, with the glory which I had with thee before the world was. So when Jesus came, he was empty of the glory. He now became man, natural man, and went through all the process. And when he was done, he made that prayer. He made that. This was the prayer for original glory. Why? Because Jesus was trying to do something. The glory of the former house. Sorry. The glory of the later house. The present house. This glory of the second Adam. Are you listening to me? Are you following me? The glory of the second Adam. Are you following me? Now, before I finish that sentence, the number for God is 7. The number for man is 6. Thou hast made man a little bit lower than the angels. That word angels is not the ordinary angels. If you go to your Bible and check well, that word angels is plural and it is called Elohim. Elohim is God himself. So thou hast made us a little bit lower than Elohim. Are you listening to me? So now, Jesus, what Adam lost, which was number 6, are you following me? Jesus now was coming with number 7. The glory of this present house will be better than the glory of the former house. 7 is better than 6. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
I said 7 is better than 6. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
What is 7? 7 means complete. 7 means complete. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Are you still with me?
Oh yes.
I did not hear you. Are you still with me?
Oh yes.
Now look at that scripture right there. He said, and the glory which thou gavest me. So it means that Jesus made that prayer and the prayer was answered. Are you following me?
Oh yeah.
And the glory which thou gavest me, I have given them. Given who? Given them. I have given them that they may be one, even as we are one. I don't know if you understand something there. The glory which thou gavest me, I have given them. I have given the church. Somebody say the church.
Yes,
I have given the church. The glory which you gave me, I have given the church. That the church will be one. Somebody say will be one. As we are one. Let us make man in our likeness and in our image. Oh, hallelujah. See, the glory of God, when it comes, you will rest.
Amen.
Are you listening to me? When the glory of God comes, you will not struggle. Why? Because God will be the one doing it.
Amen.
And I was telling you that there will be a day that I will take time to preach on faith, anointing, and glory. When the man of God operates in the anointing, by the time he is done, he will be tired. But when the glory of God comes, after you finish preaching, you will not be tired. Amen. That's the difference, because that day God was doing the work.
Amen.
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 Well, there will be a day that we'll talk about it. So in Genesis chapter 1, 26, God said, let us make man in our image and likeness. Man was clothed with glory and honor. Man was full of glory and honor. Somebody say, praise the Lord.
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 The glory is coming back to the church.
Amen.
I did not hear you. I said, the glory is coming back to the church.
Amen.
The glory is coming back to the church.
Amen.
The glory which thou hast given me, I have given them.
Yes.
The glory has been given.
Yes, Lord.
I have given them that they may be one, even as we are one. Praise the name of the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Oh, hallelujah. The glory is coming back.
Amen.
The glory of the Lord is upon me. I am blessed every day. The glory of the Lord is upon me. I am blessed every day. Hallelujah. The glory of the Lord. I want you to sing that song with some seriousness. Oh, I am blessed every day. What I just put right there. That is the ark of the covenant of God. That was what God asked Moses to construct. He said, make this box. I know my picture is not really clear, but just manage with, just bear with me. You see how it is? If you look well, you will see a pole. God says, make a ring and insert the pole. Make four rings, put the pole. Because nobody is supposed to touch the ark. Are you listening to me? Because the glory of God can bring protection as well as judgment. Nobody is supposed to touch the ark, and nobody is supposed to see what is in the ark. So every time that you need to move the ark, we just need two able men. One that way, one this way, and they carry the poles on their shoulder and move with the ark. Nobody is to touch the ark. Now when this ark was gone for 20 years, when David came as the king, David wanted to bring back the ark. 20 years. So David made arrangement and he sent men. They went there, they carried the ark. But what happened was the pole was not there. Are you listening to me? The pole was not there. So they tied the ark, you know, somewhere. They tied it on the animal. And something happened on the way. While they were rejoicing and coming back, the animal stumbled and the box was about to fall to hit the ground. So one of the guys who was taking care of the box reached out to catch it. He actually caught it, put it down. But by the time he finished, he was dead. Are you listening to me? By the time he was done, he was dead. God says, do not touch. It is holy. Carrying him on the pole. That guy was judged. So David was so angry. He said, I am trying to work for God, and God cannot appreciate me. Listen to me and listen good. You cannot work for God. You must learn how to work with God. Are you listening to me? With God, but Adam walked away from God. Every time that there is sin and guilt, people walk away from God. Are you listening from me? Are you listening to me? Anytime that people are guilty, they walk away from God. But when people reconcile with God, oh, thank God for the blood of Jesus. The Bible says that we can enter into His presence with boldness because of His blood. Hallelujah.
Amen.
So the ark, David went and studied the law that God gave Moses. When he studied the law, he discovered that the pole was not there. That was the problem. So they inserted another pole and they carried the ark. And when they did that, they were able to bring this ark to Jerusalem. There was great rejoicing. And David built a city called the City of David. And the ark of God was there. And then David told God, said, God, I want to build a temple where this ark will be. And God laughed. now and say, you cannot work for me. You cannot, you cannot, you cannot even build a temple for me. Don't worry. You have fought so many battles, your hand is full of blood. But because you have this great idea, I will not forget, your family will never be cut off from this kingship. So I will remember your family. Your son will be the one to build the temple. The Bible says that when Solomon came to reign, Solomon was the son of David. Solomon built the temple and he did everything. There were priests who were consecrated. The Bible says that on a certain day, while the priests were doing their normal worship consecration, that smoke filled the whole temple, that they could not stand anymore. And all of them rushed back. The glory showed up again. The glory that was lost, the glory came back. Is somebody listening to me? The glory came back to Israel. The glory of God will be part of this ministry. If you believe, just shout a big amen. The glory of God will be part of your life. Thank God for the Holy Ghost. The Bible says that ye are the temple of the living God.
Yes.
The Holy Ghost will make his permanent dwelling in you. Amen. God was angry with Adam. God was angry with human race. And God said, my spirit shall no longer strive with men. And so God withdrew his spirit. But when Jesus was about to go back to heaven, Jesus looked at the disciples and said, oh, my peace I give unto you. Do you know the meaning of peace? Peace means nothing missing, nothing broken. Everything that was lost, I'm giving you back. He said, my peace I give unto you. Jesus prayed unto the disciples. He released the bread. That bread that was taken from Adam, Jesus gave it back to the apostles. Is somebody listening to me? He said, receive ye the Holy Ghost. He said, stay here until you are clothed, until you become one with the one. The glory is coming back. 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 Oh, hallelujah.
Amen.
The glory is coming back. Stand to your feet, somebody. Your body is the temple of the Holy Ghost. God has decided to bring his glory in your life. And by virtue of that glory, every challenge in your life will bow.
Amen.
By virtue of that glory, your enemies that used to laugh at you, they will see the other side of the story.
Yes.
By virtue of that glory, you will prosper.
Amen.
By virtue of that glory, peace will find your home.
Amen.
By virtue of that glory, no situation will be above you.
Amen.
That glory is coming back.
Amen.
I want you to lift up your voice wherever you are. Just begin to thank the Lord for such a time like this. God is reminding us that he is releasing his glory back to the church. Hallelujah. Father, we just give you the glory. We give you the glory, Lord. Hallelujah. We give you the glory. We give you the glory. We give you the glory. Thank you, Lord Jesus. We give you the glory. You are